livelihood has a relevance to someone's dignity, someone's security. You know, if imagine today someone is struggling for a livelihood, which means that they are not leading a dignified life. We are not giving security or secure life. So since morning you have been hearing these statistics. You know, out of 1.3 billion people, there are billion people who are at the bottom of the pyramid. You know, they don't have access to the basic things. If I look at the world, there are 2.6 billion people whose income is less than $2 a day. $2 a day. In fact, many of us who are sitting here, $2 is nothing but having a coffee in a cafe coffee day, or perhaps buying a chocolate for a child or for a friend. But there are 2.6 billion people whose incomes are so low. But if I even reduce the income levels, say let's say $1.25 per day, there are close to 1.6 billion people whose incomes are less than $1.25 a day, where you can't even get a coffee or a bar of chocolate. Now all these people are highly vulnerable, social, economic, and many other aspects. Now, if I look at India, for example, when we say out of 1.3 billion people, billions people are poor, what it means is that the majority of the people in India, majority of the people in India have income below $2, and there are many, many people, substantial number of people whose income is less than $1.25 a day, which means that we need to change. We need to change these numbers. We need to provide the basic dignity for a person, a basic livelihood for a person and family. So, for this discussion, what we will do is, the four panelists, they have organizations who have been able to deal with this particular problem. And then we have two people who are trying to help us to deal with their challenges or connect the dots so that the next level of growth can happen, next level of scale can happen. Because it is not about, we are talking about billion people, or changing the life of the billion people. It's not a small size, it's a very, very, very big work that requires to be done. But somewhere we need to start. So my request to you, the panelist, is speak about your organization, what you have been able to do, what has been the impact, and what are the challenges. And we can take, say, 8 to 10 minutes to do this. Then we have Rema and Dr. Manjunath, then give their perspective, they can even get the clarification. And after that, as a moderator, I'm going to moderate the discussion, or I will have some questions. But also, my request is that let's make this a very, very interactive session, so that I would like to hear your views, your perspectives, your points in this conversation. It's a dialogue, it's not about it's a one-way discussion.
I was an organization called Team Trade. Team Trade was founded on the ideals of transparency and traceability. We actually procure, in a nutshell, we procure agricultural products from close to 30,000 farmers and then sell it to the consumers.
Without bylaws, we can speak. As I said, I'll repeat it just for clarity. TrueTrade is a company which was actually founded on twin ideals of transparency and traceability. We deal with the agriculture sector, where we deal with close to 30,000 farmers across the states of Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana. As I said, the twin ideals were transparency and traceability. So when you buy an organic product from TrueTrade, the entire profit and loss statement what the customer actually pays is printed on the back of the packet. So how much of the money goes to the farmer, it is printed on the packet. The transportation cost, both inbound and outbound, gets printed on the packet. The packaging and building, the company's salary and administration costs, the dealer costs, and the tax certificate also. When you add up all of it, that comes to the MRP. Now, by virtue of being able to go get into that transparent model, what we have been able to accomplish is pay that extra premium back to the farmer and give a premium product to the customer at market prices of less than 40-50%. So it actually has that will advantages of being able to go with it, right? So and then not to be also to ensure that the entire traceability isn't when you scan a QR code on our platform, you actually get to know from which farmer we are procuring, and there's a short 45-second video that comes out, just talks about what are the organic practices that that particular farmer is adopting, and just probably just gives a glimpse into his life, into the farmer's life, into his challenges that he faces, because ultimately we are just providing the marketing pages to his farmers. We are not producing those particular products ourselves, but merely being able to provide those marketing pages. And in the last 2 years, we have actually set up a shop and we have started exporting to the US. We have 50 of our own retail outlets in Hyderabad, and we are launching up the new innovative program in Bangalore called the Tela Bala. The Tela Bala, as you know, is actually a push cart vendor. So we essentially try to get these fruits and vegetables to the farm land using those push carts. And we essentially leverage some of the micro entrepreneurs to be able to go get them in the push carts so that they can actually go and sell that. So that's a little bit about what Chinchure does.
Future Agency is an NGO, and the basic assumption we started the organization was to promote as many farm producers organizations as possible. And right now we have voted 3 farmers producers organizations. One of them is Gramachetana. Gramachetana organic producers, crop producers, Savada cooperatives and registered under Savada Act. So our model to promote this FPO is to improve the livelihoods of the farming communities, especially the small and the marginal farmers, keeping in view of their requirements. We floated this organization. Sorry, can you hear me?
Yes, slightly audible, but not
clear. Yeah, with these intentions, we started working with this FPO. We started working for this FPO, and then traditionally our approach was based on the basics model. My approach was based on the basics model of livelihood triad, that is IDS, that's institutional development services at one vertex, and then it's a triangle about three vertices, IDS. Then MFS, that is the microfinance services, and then the business development services. Typically, with those approaches, we try to pursue the activities of this organization, went ahead and then started organizing the farmers. But somehow, for the first 2 years, we could not make a dent. I was not very satisfied. And then ultimately, I thought, let us go on the way the farmers are liking to conducting their agribusiness, agricultural activities. Then accordingly, we try to understand how they are producing and then how they are selling at the local level and at the APMC level, at the aggregated level also. So then we said we will start aggregating, and they were very much particular about village level aggregators to sell their farm producers. And then we went ahead with that model. We just simply went with weigh scales and other things. Started buying the commodities from those villages, and then later on they started realizing that we are serious people, and then we are serious enough to help them in a proper way. So that's how we got the confidence from the farmers, because all the organizations, they said they come and then they sell their products, pesticides, herbicides, whatever it is, and then they go back, sir, they never come back, and then they promise so many things, and then they never do anything. They give us the loan, they recover back. So in isolation, the people keep working. But my approach was to integrate all these things. But as a start, we started from the back end, that is from the access to markets.
Hi, I'm Rangan from MicroGraam. We are a Bangalore-based organization. I would call myself now a impact fund. Reason, in a micro sense, we work on projects like Dr. Athani's, who, when they start looking, taking the kind of people that they work with, small and marginal farmers, who are normally not service by the regular traditional financial institutions, including many times including my microfinance institutions. I'm not saying that you know, but there are a lot of these remote people who are much more underserved. So we look at livelihood projects such as Dr. Athani, your Baligarh, and so on, who are working on specific initiatives, but give it directly to the people through these organizations who are handholding some of these projects and enable them to reach whatever objectives they can. The model in which we raise funds, since I said we are a venture fund, the model we again go to investors, socially minded investors, but since it's micro, we are able to create a platform. Even in a macro level, one can create a technology platform. Here, we crowdsource or crowdfund from individuals predominantly, and some institutions also come on our platform. And basically, the idea is you and I should be able to make an impact. That's the idea. Not just high net worth individuals, foundations, and so on and so forth. When I say you and I, it can be, even the investment can be from 100 rupees all the way up to any amount for that matter. And we crowdsource or crowdfund and enable to reach some of these projects that we are working with. That's a simple term that we are. We have been working in this area for the last 5 years, impacted close to 16,000 households today. Happy with the kind of impact. Clearly, the need is much, much larger. I think since the topic, one of the key areas was the scaling. Is this model scalable? Yes, I think we have been able to scale to a reasonable extent, but given the market demand so high, what are the ways, what are the learnings, and what are the challenges? I just want to highlight on that, given that the model is okay to highlight some of the challenges. Yeah. One of the things that we felt is social impact. I mean, clearly there is a lot of interest from the people to make, hey, I want to do something good. One is they do some the grants, charities, and there are many good opportunities or organizations which are doing it. There are other, when we call about social impact organization, it is more so as an investment or as a debt or even as an equity in a socially relevant organizations. In India, I think it's growing. I think I know both Dr. Manjunath and Rema have been the big way involved in raising some of the funds for these impact related initiatives. But in our case, what I have learned is for us to scale to the level what India wants is still not mature in terms of people. There are two reasons or the two challenges that we felt. One is on the confidence on the organizations which are doing it. Not just the MicroGraam per se, even the other organization that we are working with. Though, I mean, the reason, primary reason I see is they are not marketed, quote unquote marketed well, or awareness has not been created. So the confidence doesn't come. Yes, can I go about and invest? Second, what I found is always you are impact investment is kind of, if you look at this investment value chain, I mean, at the bottommost level of risk or risk-reward relationship is your grant or charity, then your debt instruments, then your equity, and so on. Basically, the risk-reward equation. This impact investments comes somewhere between charity and debt instrument because the returns are relatively lower. But if you combine it with the social returns, it's quite high. How do you model the social returns? How each one has a different perception of, if I help a woman in Bagalkot, should I take 7.5% return, or should I take 11% return, or should I take 3%? If somebody is from that area, there is an investor named Ganesh Kadamba from in our thing. He is from Bagalkot, that side of the area. He says, he sees any investor over there, hey, he's in Bay Area. He says, I'll fund them. So that's the kind of interest. He doesn't care about the interest. As long as it's used for the right purpose. So the point that I'm trying to make is, even the perception of the social return is different for different people. How do you engage with those kind of investors? At this micro level, at a large level, HNI, we say, hey, give us 10 lakhs, 50 lakhs, or a crore. If he's convinced about the project, we just give it. But interestingly, as we go higher, for us to scale, what
I have learned and which are trying to help, because there are a lot of overheads, there are a lot of investment to be made. How do you manage that? One thing I have learned, with the scale, with some economies of scale, we probably can bring it. In other words, we can pay higher returns to the investors or take the higher cost investment. Better to do that rather than grow slowly with the impact investment, with a lower return to the investors and so on. That is some very strong learning in the last 5 to 6 years for me. Will I change? I'm changing a little bit. I'll tell you how we are changing. I think we are creating good thing is the SEBI or Indian government has brought in something called Social Venture Fund and so on, which helps us in raise some of those kind of funds with a muted return. Again, when I say muted return, the one fund that we just have floated, we are even with 11.5% return, I'm not able to attract huge set of customers for social investment. Forget the one that we are currently doing in MicroGraam today in the crowdfunding, we give maximum of 7.5% to 8%. So that is the challenge. So the learning is, for us to scale, feedback, discussion and so on, I think there has to be a way where we are able to meet the market returns. It could be 11.5 or 13.5, but still be able to do in the social impact. How and way, I think there's something to be debated, and there is way out, but for us to scale, I feel that's a way to go. With that, I
conclude. Thank you, Rangan. In fact, we have extraordinary profile, you know, you not get because of the time, but I think I have been seeing, you know, the way you are evolving, iterating, you know, experimenting and so on. So, you know, we will have more discussions as we go. So, next from ALC, this term.
Good afternoon. I represent this organization called Access Livelihoods. In simple terms, what we do is we organize rural women, mostly from tribal areas and interiors. These are either farmers, dairy farmers, or tribal women who work on forest produce, or women who are weaving handlooms. So in these four communities, we organize them into producer companies. When I say producer companies, these are companies which are owned by women directly, so they are the shareholders. Today we have around 62,400 women who are the shareholders of 19 producer companies which we have promoted. And these are across 8 clusters which are spread across 5 states. And together they are doing business. So they do business of cashew purchase and sale, paddy seed produce and sale. They do the business of handloom cloth being produced and sold in the market. They do the business of dairy milk being procured and sold in the market as products. So a variety of things, maybe 18-19 different kind of commodities which they procure and sell in the market. And mostly the sale is done by the women themselves, so therefore the brands are owned by them. So we have a brand called Chitrika which is owned by the women. They produce the handloom cloth. There is a brand called as Swakrushi which looks at milk being procured from the dairy farmers and being sold in the market. So in a nutshell, basically we are trying to incubate companies which will be owned by women, large scale projects, and trying to organize them into produce a company which will be owned by them and then incubate their own business. Business model is almost similar to what Athani and these people are doing, except that here the women are themselves the owners and they do the business by themselves. So I'll wait for the questions.
What is it? It's a great but just explain, you know, that business model, you know. So you create, incubate the companies.
Yes.
So what do you get in return?
We charge a fee.
You charge the fees. Okay, that's the.
So we have a fee structure which is across all the stages of development. So if you have to mobilize farmers and organize them into a company, either a government or this one farmer themselves pay, it comes to around 2,000 to 2,500 rupees per farmer. And then once they are through that phase, when they have to set up their own processing unit, we charge 7% fee over the total project. So if they are putting up a dairy plant, which is 10,000 liter dairy plant, we charge 7% of the total cost, which is 4 crores. And then once the business is established, the processing unit is established, when they do the marketing, we charge a fee or the profit they generate.
Very interesting. So how many companies you have been able to incubate? 19 companies. Excellent, excellent. I think we'll have a very good discussion on this particular model. So, you know, all these four models that we heard are very interesting, very unique, very innovative. Whether it is transparent pricing, whether transparent weighing and, you know, building this whole supply chain and so on, to creating incubating companies and crowdsourcing for financing. It's a, all four have been doing great work and demonstrated that it works and it is working. Now, Rema, you are an impact investor. You look at impact very seriously. Of course, we have a different model to create an impact. Now that you have looked these four different organizations, NGOs to, you know, social entrepreneurs. So, you know, what do you think? You know, what they should be doing, or whether you need some, you know, what are your expert, you know, remarks, comments, and so on? Because the model of panel discussion is very different. So I think you have to play your role.
Remove the word expert. Should remove all those words, all those adjectives that we remove. So I would rather say as a fact that this is perhaps a way of perhaps loud thinking of questions, and that's what I would say. It's not the word expert. Because they all have far more expertise on the ground than I have. So a couple of questions that I had was, one was, and perhaps I will just break it up in a couple. One was from creating a brand value, because I think he touched upon it a bit. And what does it take to build a brand and the cost it is associated with it? Because underlying that is that in any livelihood, or for that matter, in any returns that you need at any point, you always find that, and this is not because I say it or otherwise, worldwide, a brand commands more value than the commodity itself. Two questions. First one, maybe if we have enough time.
Tomorrow, if 24/7 Nandra comes and says, I need you to do something, you will go to that. Because he does not have. I mean, fact of the matter is, it's like me changing the job because somebody else pays. So, where does brand building come
from? Coming in as a self and software background, irrespective of all the different platforms that exist in the software, the open source platform are still being predominant in the industry that came in front of you. So a lot of, let's say, you have to Java, or you have to some of the open source, you know, applications and products are actually owned by those consumers, right? So, and people actually would take that code, people actually be able to Linux code, they kind of prepare and have a different platform of that, added extensions for that, and develop that code. So it's actually the crowd of those developers who actually own that particular brand are the proponents of that particular brand. Now, if I need to essentially extrapolate that same concept onto what they're going to do here, brand ambassadors, and that's the ecosystem that they're going to do, are A, the farmers, and number two, the consumers. So by being able to go create that emotional connect of bringing in the place of the need where you tell the consumer, you know, what's going on in the life of a farmer, what are his farming practices, what are his strategies. Maybe give a phone number, we give the village details, so we can actually spend some time with that. So, A, by ensuring that you focus on both farmers and consumers, and let that ecosystem drive that for that. And that's our philosophy, we are also able to build that. And per se, being in the not-for-profit sector and having spent almost 2 years with Akshay Patra Foundation, one of the biggest lessons that we have essentially learned is to be able to ensure that you let the people who are actually benefiting be part of this entire ecosystem. So back in Akshay Patra, when the school child got benefited by consuming the food that was actually doing, and the gentleman who was there earlier at Chinchure with us probably did not mention one thing aspect that 8% of Akshay Patra's funds today are coming in from children who benefited by eating the food that was essentially served. That was probably one statistic that he might be. So the point is, how do you think some speed? So it's a good question. So our philosophy is the crowdsourcing. And
I think Rema had a very interesting point. If I look at from a commodity point of view, like if I'm selling a commodity product, you know, the brand sometimes becomes very important. But anyway, just look
at what he says is that he is building a brand. But it's not that he has to spend
separately. As far as retail market is concerned, brand is required. Brand and only name is required. And then that's how we started with a brand name called Simply Sattvic.
Simply
Sattvic. Sattvic is a Sanskrit word. They're not even actually because it's more valuable for the human life. So, since we are dealing with organic farm, organic commodities and organic ingredient products, so we went ahead with the Simply Sattvic. After due consultation with the producers as well as the consumers also. And under that brand name only, we are undertaking also.
How are you creating a brand? See, by just putting a label out there,
you are not
creating
a brand. It doesn't create a brand.
I mean, there are enough and more Ganesh
properties. That label is only the identity.
The identity is not enough to create the commodity from a 10 rupee per kg to the fact that the farmer has to get 20 rupees per kg. How does that has to be
created? No, here the primary purpose is approach is to have a market driven thing for the commodities. We have to educate consumers. We have to undertake lots of promotional activities. Like now, TV screening is going on aggressively, and then a lot of media, then home to home delivery cases also. We have created our own e-commerce website also, buysafefoods.com. Wherein the people are slowly visiting that website and then placing the orders also. So it all is done to promote that particular label. That's how we are creating a value for the commodity, which we are procuring from the group of farmers, certified group of farmers in the dryland context. So that we are trying to emphasize on the consumers that every rupee he pays to buy that commodity, at least I would say major portion of it goes to pay back to the farmers. So that is a value we are trying to create, and it goes to add to his livelihood profiles to benefit their children's education, health, etc. So we are creating a value for the consumers to buy this Simply Sattvic. Not only just for, he doesn't just pay for the commodity, he also pays for the welfare of the farmer. So that's a message we have created, and I think it is being heard by the consumers.
Thank you very much. Now I will go to Dr. Manjunath. So I am not calling you as an expert, but as per the structure, it is respondent. So you are a respondent too.
Just speak on the brand.
Quick.
So we have the experience of launching two brands. One sells dairy products called as Swakushi. It sells around 89 crores last year. The product's worth around 89 crores. The other brand is called as Chitrika, which sells around handrooms of 4.5 crores. They are two different commodities, so I should tell what has happened in both these places. Obviously, we are not investing huge money like any other brand builders are doing. So what we have done here is we go by our strength, and that's what both Dr. Athani and these people have directed. So when we launched the milk, what we did was we virtually gave sample packs and did a household campaign where nearly 800 rural women went to the urban areas of Varangal and then went around and then. So the day when we see in two three days we see 800 women going around and then campaigning house to house, it creates a lot of urgency, lot of media coverage, lot of business. So it's a kind of a gorilla way of doing it, but it works. And then from there on, it's the product quality which takes over. So the moment we realize that the product quality is quite good, then there is a substantial demand that comes in. But the backend has to be prepared. That means you should be able to reach out to so many retail outlets. The product should be available where the consumer is looking for, and all that. So we could manage to do so many retailers and let's put all these things in place. So that's one story. The other story was handloom cloth. So here the consumer is quite dispersed because you know you are reaching a high-end consumer. So in this kind of a scenario, what we have done is we have chosen to carefully select 20-30 exhibitions across the country, and their sales are very good. We have displayed our products, did good sales on an average 2 to 3 lakhs every day sales in these kind of exhibitions, and that itself created a big pull. Now, because the consumer is making a choice that this is the product that is required, you see that a lot of buyers, boutique buyers, the small players, they all started coming in directly. We have a small shop in Hyderabad, and from there they pick up and then go. So both the ways we have used much low cost courier kind of thing, and a brand which can stably generate profits. Both brands are making substantial profits. The dairy one makes 6 crores surplus every year. The handloom one has at least 30-40 lakhs as on day as surplus.
I think we will not change the topic because we cannot have the same brand. Dr. Manjunath, you have such a great experience, you know, reading in fact and that you do.
This goes slightly backward. We talked about the old marketing. But before marketing, we want to scale up. We need to have quality. And that's why the biggest problem when we are talking of vulnerable people. If they are traditionally producing a particular product, then they have quality conscious already. We are bringing more and more people. We are scaling up, bringing in more and more people to produce commodities. Mm-hmm. Sticking to quality is a very big issue. And we are talking of quality, somewhere we need to bring in entrepreneurial skills. If you want to transfer, you are, you know, different, like you said, you have 19 MPOs, and Athani has also open MPOs. And when you are trying to transfer the whole setup, we need to have entrepreneurial skills. And entrepreneurial skills also go back to producing quality products. So how do you manage quality? Well, I think it will move. I'll ask this question to you because you're working on dairy products. Come back to you also. How do you ensure quality? One thing. How do you ensure actually entrepreneurial skills in the grassroots bottom of the pyramid producers?
So I'll take the quality question. Quality, I think, has to do with how you go about first sitting with the farmers and defining what is the kind of market standards that are required. So once we are clear with what is the kind of market standards that are required, whether it is cashew, turmeric, or any of these commodities you take, we look back what is it that the consumer is trying to look forward for, and what is it that is getting a premium price in the market, and what parameters are there behind it. Maybe it is moisture content, maybe it is the chemical composition that is more important, or sometimes it's just the physiological factors that has to be looked at. So all of these are very clearly defined. In a handloom cloth, it is based on even the quality of yarn that is used, the dyeing quality, that is how much is the retention, that is the levels are there. We also define it based on how close the weaving has been, what is the kind of thing. So we have all these parameters very clearly defined from the consumer's perspective. And once that is defined, we train internally the women themselves to first internalize this, all these standards. And then we build incentive and disincentive kind of a structure for them. So the incentive structure is very clear. We clearly establish standards, and against that standards, if somebody is performing better, they get a better pay. And if they are not performing, they get a disincentive. So this is ingrained from the day one, and if you do that, then probably it works.
But then it will lead to dropouts, and actually it will also lead to turnover.
That's the second part.
Then your production is affected.
Yeah.
There's a turnover,
yeah.
You are sticking to quality,
yeah.
And then those who are below that level,
yeah.
If you ask them, actually incentivize them.
Yeah.
Then there's a turnover.
Yeah. So
then how do you keep your
production? Yeah, so there are two things, like there is a pre-qualifying stage. Not everybody will qualify to come to a production level, because brand sanctity is very important and the quality maintenance is very important, whatever you do. Even if you in a hurry add up people, at the end of the day, if the consumer is not going to buy the product, then we are not going to do justice.
True, but then how do you do?
Yeah, so what we do is we have a preparatory stage where we work with weavers, dairy farmers. We have a structured module around how to improve the productivity enhancement, whether it is agriculture farmers also. So these modules we take them through for 3 to 6 months, have a demonstration plots, show all these things, then slowly they pick up.
Do I have time for one or two?
One more question, huh?
One or two more questions.
One question, then we will. Okay. I think let's start some kind of a real discussion now.
This question will go to MicroGraam. You talked of actually being competitive in the market, otherwise you're not surprised. When you talk of market, it's all good risk-taking. Okay. So now you're trying to be an impact funder, and you are talking of an interest rate around that top percent. Very interesting. In India, we expect funds at much lower rates, and NABARD coming in, chipping in for FPOs and grant funding. So you're in a very challenging field. So how does risk-taking work in terms of impact funding, and how do you actually make them understand that this is involved in?
Yeah, the way we manage the risk is bringing in the work that we have done so far. We show that, I think, let's say, just take the case of the fund that we are just creating. It's a 25 crore fund, small fund. Now we are saying, hey, we have looked at it for the last 5 years. These are the creamy layer of the organizations who have performed well and the kind of impact that they are creating. Now, as you rightly pointed out, when I say higher interest to the investors in this case, would I pass on that higher interest back to the ultimate borrowers in this particular case because we are investing in debt? In a way, yes, but not the whole amount. Let's assume, today I am doing 7.5% MicroGraam crowdsourcing platform. We give it at a maximum of 16% to the borrowers. So there is a clear spread of about 9%, it goes to the NGO and the MicroGraam. Now, even though it is going to be 11.5% to the lenders, I will not be passing on all the 4% to the borrower, rather only about 2% to the borrower because of the scale. Okay, now the question is, now will this 16 to 18% jump will create a higher risk in terms of the repayment? In a way, yes, but not a substantial extent, which we are able to minimize by able to have organizations which are much more credit worthy. So, if I have
a risk,
it's spreading my risk, and also of the 36, I may have A, B, C, and I will be giving money to the A.
Thank you very much. Anyway, the panel was structured like this. We have respondents and then some success stories. I think we need to bring the discussion to more on livelihoods. What we discussed now is what you have been able to do. Once you have a produce, what do you do? Take it to the market and so on. I think my question to some of you, some of you can take it. What has really changed on the ground? What has really happened? Say, for example, by transparent pricing. So what has changed? And what is the potential that exists? How much potential we are leveraging to do this? I think these are some of the fundamental questions, both from socio-economic point of view, what has changed on the ground, and we should discuss that, in this round of this discussion. But, you can start with
something on similar lines in terms of livelihoods. So I understand what you're discussing is about organizational scale, but what I would really advise that in this session is to understand how many more livelihoods could your model create. And I work very closely with NSDC with a lot of skill training centers, and we interview youth. So if you look at it, the long-term sustainability or profitability of all your organizations is going to be how many people would be interested in getting a livelihood that you offer. I really feel the aspirations of today's generation is not so traditional in nature. They do want to work in banking, they do want to work in IT, etc. So what is the new age technology, what is the new kind of livelihoods that your traditional models create for the youth of today? For you to actually have scalability in the long run. So your brand is all fine, in terms of quality is all fine, but what is new that you're giving the youth, because that's what's going to define our economy tomorrow.
With our experience with another LPO, called as a sheep and goat, of course this animal part we are not supposed to discuss with the DM forums here, but with a due exception, because we are still working with MicroGraam. We are getting a lot of support to infuse funds to increase production of these lambs and kids and rearing at the beneficiaries level. So here, our two sets of beneficiaries we have inducted. The first one is the landless women laborers who were, who goes for the labor work without disturbing their routine livelihoods. We have added one more portfolio to rear the lamps, lamp threatening with the buyback from the cooperative. So there really it has worked. But as far as your concern about the youth is concerned, suffering and then go to very, nowadays nobody wants. And then they are getting deserted. But in the contrary, I have got all the statistics that shows that many of the people, especially youth, from other than Kurwa and then scheduled caste community, they are coming into the shepherding activities nowadays. So they are trying to rework on the model with a little bit of tinkering. They are coming forward because of the profits and then the lesser risk and then the support from the government as well as the NGOs like us, organizations. So looking to those and then the ease of funding for shepherding, if a shepherd has to borrow the loan, 6 months he has to roam around the bank to get the loan because of the security issues and other things. Nobody would like to lend for the sheep and goat. But it's a great greatness of the MicroGraam that they allowed us.
They want to be shepherds, they want to be vets.
Yes.
So what are we doing for to make them vets and not just shepherds or farmers?
As long as you give them dignified livelihoods, income generation, there should not be a difference between the IT fellow and the shepherd. That's what is my conviction.
Yes, sir. Yes. That's exactly what I was trying to point out. All these initiatives, what they are trying to do, they are going to create a niche in their sectors. For instance, he is talking of Navadana, Siridana. Siridana is the niche sector. So youngsters can come into this sector, they can get a better price, they can get a better opportunity to scale up. And similarly, the e-marketing thing that the other gentleman is speaking, So this is another niche sector where you are actually trying to transform from the grassroots to the buyer with a minimum transactional cost, so that the value that he gets is going to increase manifold, and at the same time the consumer is going to get a better product at a better price, and the middleman, the youngster that you are talking of, is also going to get a better standing. And so this, I think the 19 FPOs that they were referring to, all are actually looking at the vulnerable section. They are not in the IT, they are not in the PT, but they are entirely vulnerable, but they are now going to lead a very dignified life, like it was pointed out initially, by having a standard market and a standard product, like Chitrika. I mean, that's it. Now it is a branded product, so you under that brand umbrella, you are scaled up. So it's, the question is, how many more can we bring into this umbrella? So that's the challenge which they have to face, which they will be working out actually in the future.
Sorry, just one thing. The point is that is they've done a great job, right? And I'm just adding to her point. Is that, is it about getting more people into it? Because what will happen is the fact that the people who have moved from the vulnerability to now a slightly more comfortable position, their aspiration levels will now shoot up drastically, especially their children. Would want now to 10 times more than not. It might take them 50 years to reach where they are, but now their expectation will suddenly shoot up. Now you can't go back to them and tell them, until yesterday you did not have anything, now you are giving you 10 rupees more. Why? You tell them, they will do that. So I think where she is coming from is that how are you going to handle, one is of course, there is still a huge population which is very vulnerable. There is a population which has moved from vulnerability just this stage. How is it that as livelihoods that you guys are going to ensure that you are able to meet their aspirational level? Because otherwise you will have a huge contrast there. So that's the part.
Sorry, just one last point. Just to frame it a little better, how do you make traditional industries? So I absolutely see merit in traditional industries and everything you do. But how do you make it in your business models, make it more lucrative or interesting for the next generation of people who would have to do this? Because they won't be that skilled like the IT sector or anything. So what I'm saying, how would you all work on your future scalable plans to make it more lucrative to the youth of India?
I would recoil only one word of your question. Not lucrative, but glamorous.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Because what's the alternative? I mean, I've seen a lot of skill development. We are also a national skill development program, it's important. And what's the alternative? Most youth get trained and then they get placed in retail shops, stand for 12 hours. Is it really any great job? There's nothing great. You go and become a security guard, is it really great? Nothing. You become a phone caller, is it so great? Nothing. Actually, more boring jobs. There are more boring jobs than doing a creative handloom cloth or rearing animal, where you really develop affection for the animals and all those. So they are completely different. So what the only element is about glamour, and the way we are trying to look at glamour is in two three dimensions. One is if the farmer earlier was probably doing 1 acre or 2 acres, can I increase it to 5 acres, have precision irrigation facilities, produce more commercial commodities, and therefore the returns to the farmer is attractive for the youngster to be involved in it. Or if there is a dairy farmer who does probably 1 or 2 animals, today we can look at a 5 to 10 animal kind of a dairy farm where there is milking machines, which is the latest technology that is coming into. Look at traditional breeds, which is again has A2 protein, and therefore the market realizations are much more higher. So there are many mechanisms by which you can actually make the traditional occupations really glamorous for the youngsters. Change the scale, try and improve the lethargy. There was a lot of drudgery in the primary production. So can we reduce the drudgery? That's the second issue. So if you reduce drudgery, probably it becomes more attractive to the youngsters. And we see a lot of them coming back. I have seen many viewers who probably left their homes in Srikakulam where we were doing, came to Hyderabad. All they were doing was standing in a mill as security guard and all. Then the moment this producer company started doing well, they all come back and they started doing. What we have done, we have done the things.
I think we can take this. I think it's leading to a very interesting discussion, because see, for me, livelihood, of course, it's a very, very broad, I think, we can go to different dimensions. See, there is a young youth today. You know, if I go to villages, so much of youth, they don't have much work to do, or they don't have skills to do. See, agriculture, unfortunately, you know, 60% of the agriculture engaged in the agriculture, but GDP is only, what, 15% or so. So that's not something which might be very, you know, a great area to get into. So, how do we engage the youth? Number two, how do we engage vulnerable women and families? You know, there are women in the families. You know, how can we make them more self-sustaining and have the opportunity for them, you know, for a livelihood and also be part of this, in economically developed family? Can you touch a little bit about how are we, you know, engage these vulnerable set of Naveen, I think you are sitting or thinking. Can I touch upon a few things?
That was a wonderful question. Good answer. Nicely. I think if you can actually put that being clever and be professional, and also be able to put more money in the pockets of those vulnerable people, I think that's where the change will happen. It's probably not going to happen. And the fact is that, like the rest of the countries, we will probably move towards, have already moved towards the services economy, we will probably continue to keep going that path. That's probably not going to change. But the point is that can we essentially subsequently get more people back into this part? And I think it would be yes. There are quite a few stories for such a community. So, the same example of more. Can I essentially get a farmer now stand up and say, the bill that I'm actually milking right now for the cow has more people, and by the way, I make money, and take the drudgery out from the work we have done, and be able to find a marketplace where we can actually go sell this out. I think that's probably what is going to drive people who are coming into this world. So that's probably my idea.
The young
people. I think can I move to others?
Yeah.
Because hardly any time left, I think. So we will appreciate other
some
points.
Other questions. In fact, I wanted to, you know, talk to.
Yeah, please. Sorry. Go ahead,
I have a question for you, ma'am. This is your talking about building a brand. So we are currently in the space of actually building a brand for the products that women are making. So what would be a good way to position it? Do you actually pitch it with the commercial players in the market, or do you actually brand yourself as
such? I think we can take that question offline.
Okay.
This discussion is about,
yeah,
and my point of brand was to say is that can brand create a higher income and all that. I'm happy to chat, but let's do that after.
So there is a very during lunch I heard very interesting story from Ramnathan, if I remember correctly. I think you had touched upon very interesting point about, you know, doing certain things without impacting the livelihood and how to bring the youth into, you know, unorganized to organized. Can you please share, you know, your experience on this?
We heard what we talk about as villages, underprivileged, vulnerable and all that stuff. There's a whole bunch of stuff that goes around in metros and cities and stuff like that, what we call as the urban poor and the rest of the sections of society, which by no means they're called poor, but they're not rich either. So they are stuck in a livelihood which remains their livelihood throughout their life. That's not because of they wanted to do it, but that's what they've been taught to do. And one of the sections that we deal with is the Gabaliwalas. I'm talking about the Gabaliwalas that comes to your homes. By no means he's rich, but he's not poor either. So there's a big difference between, because he's doing a business. But thing is, that imagine the fact that he's doing business in that section of the play that he's in, is because that's what he's been trained to do. Now how do you make a change that, and why is he doing it, and why is it important to him to be directed towards somewhere else, is because of the indirect cost on himself, his family and the environment around him. So if you were to take, I mean, I was just telling somebody, and Aravind as well earlier, our fundamental belief as a company or as a person, I fundamentally believe is that no business can compete with livelihood. No business, ever. You just cannot compete with livelihood. You can compete with another business. If your business is impacting somebody's livelihood, there's no way. What these people are here doing is to change somebody's livelihood, bring them new businesses and things like that. If I wear a halo over my head and say that I'm a recycler, what you guys are doing a bunch of nonsense. You should not give stuff to Kabaddiwalas anymore. You have to give it to me. It's not going to work.
Yeah,
because you are going to impact. It's not going to change.
Not changing language. Let's get it right. They are all in their language. Nobody is changing language. They are actually adding values to the language.
Exactly.
Scaling them up. And then, you know, bringing other values. So they are not changing. Let's get this right. None of them are changing anything.
Even I am not going to change here.
Yeah.
I think what happens is that when we try to change, when new businesses come in,
that's where a lot of the effort and all.
Here, what's happening is when you get into businesses that try to change livelihoods, then you get into trouble.
Yeah.
The reasons where some of these FPOs and NGOs has failed is because they try to change livelihoods. There are so many NGOs that come to the foundation and we talk to so many people. And I've been fortunate to be part of the Deshpande Foundation from day one. And I've been here for a long time. For a different purpose altogether. But what I'm trying to say here is that when we actually deal with livelihoods of people, as long as we elevate them, we kind of do interventions and do that, that's probably okay. To answer her question, what she's saying is, can we get the youth to do something different? Can we take aspirations? Is 10,000 rupees better? Is 20,000 rupees better? And can we do something different? I'm not so sure. So, can we get this IT people, and that was your, because of your training background. But what I'm, the question that Aravind had here, I'm sorry, the question that Aravind had here was that my experience with some of the livelihoods that I talked to and I have been, but all I'm just, in one second, just wanted to say this, because you wanted me to just tell that, is simply because that when we intervene in livelihoods, all we need to be careful is the fact that we can't wear the halo over our head and then say, I mean, what I'm doing is right. It just cannot happen. As long as we kind of intervene in a fashion where it actually kind of elevates them, that's the only stuff that's going to work. And that also is kind of going to be short term because we have not actually solved the problem. We are only trying to understand the problem. That problem will get changed and become better when the next generation of that livelihood starts taking over the business. When they say, okay, fine, this livelihood is good enough for us to grow in life. That's what is going to change livelihood.
Let me...
Yeah,
anyone has a question, otherwise...
let me close the session. Anyone has a question? No? Okay. So, I think in India, we need several interventions. It's not one intervention. And what we saw today are few interventions, very successful interventions, programs that have made a difference. And all the four that we heard today were unique, were new, brought something different to change on the ground, change the society, particularly at the rural part of the India. When I look at the impact, so actually I was coming more from how can we make poor people, because change their life. Because for me, when I go to, you know, rural parts of India, there are people. I'm not talking about Western Karnataka or developed Karnataka or Western Maharashtra, but if you go to some regions, say even part of Marathwada or say part of Uttar Pradesh, I was traveling in Uttar Pradesh, I see there is a poverty. You know, there's so much of poverty that there are families who are not sure whether they are going to get a food today evening or perhaps in the next few days. Now here is a problem, it's a big problem. So there are people in the families, there are young people, there are old people, there are people at the age 30, 40, but they do not have an opportunity for a livelihood. Now that's a fundamental problem. I think we need to do, you know, many things to ensure that every person, every citizen of this nation has very basic necessities of life. Now, what does this mean to India? It means that if we want to see an India which is an economically and socially developed nation, or economically developed nation, where there are no vulnerable families, where there are no poor families, where there are no children who do not get an access to the basic education or health care, if we have to reach to that particular stage, we need a different model of economic development. What it means is that we need to create access equality in spite of economic inequality. Economic inequality is going to happen. There is a lot of poverty in India. That poverty will remain. Of course, there are rich people in India. But the situation should not be that the poor people will remain poor just because they do not have access to the basic things, access to the food, sanitation, water, healthcare, education, financial services. Only way we can make this nation prosperous is to provide access equality in spite of economic inequality. I think this is going to be a big challenge, or going to be the way for a inclusive, equitable economic development or prosperity of the nation. Now what does this mean, you know, access equality? What it means is that if the families, if the people get basic access, once they come to the mainstream, and believe me, the real change will happen. Today they don't have a basic access, therefore they are not part of economic development. Once they come into the mainstream, that they will be part of the overall economic development of the nation, the prosperity of the nation. So it's extremely important for us to look at livelihood from economic or livelihood from access part of view. If we ensure now that access can happen by many different ways, either, you know, having this model of transparent pricing and sourcing, or your organic food and retaining and branding, or creating these entrepreneurs or group of entrepreneurs, or through impact investment. These are all the interventions one can have, ensure that everyone gets the basic necessities of the life once they get it, irrespective of their economic condition. And once that happens, believe me, all these people will come into the mainstream, and then we will see the real prosperity, the real Samruddha nation. If you want to make a Samruddha nation, I think we need to first deal with the livelihood. Youth cannot sit idle in the rural parts of India. We have to give them vocational education, we have to bring them, give them a basic access so that they become part of, you know, the economic development or inclusive development of the nation. So thank you very much. I knew that this was afternoon. The topic is very broad. There are six panelists. And of course, this is not an environment we are used to, because there is a sweat, there is a heart, and of course discussions were going all the different ways. But I really appreciate that you sat, you heard different perspectives, and stayed till 4 o'clock. So thank you very much for being part of this great audience.
So I thank gentlemen, all the panelists and respondents and public teachers here as well. So as a token of gratitude, I kindly request you to hand over the token.
Thank you very much. Now we see some hundreds of...
Excuse me.
Thank you, Rema. Thank you, Dr. Thank you, Naveen. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.